Welcome to the FixSleep Bedtime Stories Channel, your sanctuary for relaxation, meditation, and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this journey to relaxation. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our magical sleep stories. So, let the tale begin. The Mystery of the Night's Journey. Chapter 1. The Dark Realm. As the first light of dawn broke over the horizon, Sir Alaric donned his armor, the metal plates clinking softly with each movement. His destination was the Garden of Shadows, a dense and ancient forest shrouded in perpetual darkness due to a thick canopy that allowed no sunlight to penetrate. Legends spoke of its twisted paths and the creatures that lurked within, guardians of its dark secrets. This was the first obstacle in his quest to rescue Princess Elara from the clutches of the nefarious witch Morgath. Mounted on his steadfast steed, Ethelwyn, Sir Alaric rode out from the safety of the castle gates. The journey to the Garden of Shadows took him through villages where folk peered from behind shuttered windows, their eyes wide with a mix of fear and hope. The further he rode, the more the landscape changed. The once vibrant green fields turned sallow, and a fine mist began to rise from the ground, coiling around his horse's legs like living tendrils. Upon reaching the outskirts of the Garden of Shadows, Sir Alaric paused, surveying the gnarled trees and the thick underbrush that marked its boundary. The air was cool and damp, carrying a faint, musky odor of decay. With a steadying breath, he urged Ethelwyn forward into the murk of the forest. Inside, the path was barely visible, obscured by overgrown ferns and thick moss that muffled the sound of their steps. The silence of the forest was oppressive, broken only by the occasional rustle of leaves or the distant call of an unseen creature. Sir Alaric's eyes darted from shadow to shadow, his hand resting on the hilt of his sword, ready to draw at the slightest hint of danger. As they ventured deeper into the garden, a low growl echoed through the trees. Sir Alaric dismounted, drawing his sword as shapes began to materialize from the shadows. The shadow wolves, beasts as black as the night, and with eyes glowing like coals, emerged from the underbrush, their teeth bared in silent snarls. Legends had not exaggerated their fearsome nature. With Ethelwyn nervously stamping behind him, Sir Alaric faced the pack. He knew better than to hope for a quick escape. These creatures were the forest's first line of defense, meant to deter unwelcome visitors. As the wolves circled, Sir Alaric waited for an opening, his senses heightened to their every move. The attack came suddenly, a blur of motion, as the lead wolf leaped towards him. Sir Alaric sidestepped, swinging his sword in a wide arc, the blade meeting fur and flesh with a sickening thud. The wolf fell away, yelping in pain, but its packmates pressed closer, undeterred. For several tense minutes, Sir Alaric fought fiercely, his blade a flash of silver in the dim light. With each swing, he pushed the wolves back, but there were too many, and he was tiring quickly. In a desperate move, he threw a small, fire-cracking stone to the ground, which he had prepared for emergencies. The stone erupted in a burst of bright light and sound, startling the wolves and scattering them long enough for Sir Alaric to remount Ethelwyn. heart pounding, he spurred his horse onward, deeper into the heart of the garden. The path became rougher, the vegetation thicker, and soon the air itself seemed to thicken with magic. This part of the forest was where the boundary between the natural and the supernatural blurred, where every shadow could be a portal, every whisper a spell. As night began to fall, Sir Alaric came upon a clearing that was unnaturally round, with a pond at its center that mirrored the few stars visible through the canopy. Here, he dismounted to rest, his body aching from the battle. He knew that Morgath's lair was close now, and the final confrontation was imminent. However, the forest was not yet done with him. In the eerie quiet of the clearing, a soft voice spoke, a sound so unexpected that Sir Alaric reached for his sword before he saw its source. A figure stepped from the shadows by the pond, cloaked in robes that shimmered with a light that seemed to come from within. This was no witch or ghost, but a guardian spirit of the forest, an ancient being whose presence commanded both fear and awe. "Why do you enter the Garden of Shadows, Knight of the Human Realm?" the spirit asked, its voice echoing like the wind through leaves. Sir Alaric bowed slightly, choosing his words with care. "I seek the Princess Elara, taken by Morgath. I must free her from the witch's grasp." The spirit regarded him silently for a moment, then nodded. "Your path is true, and your heart is brave. But know this, knight. The forest tests all who walk its paths. You have faced its shadows and survived. Now, you must face the darkness within yourself." With those cryptic words, the spirit vanished, leaving Sir Alaric alone once more. Shaken but resolved, he knew that whatever lay ahead, the true test of his journey was just beginning. The night grew deeper, and Sir Alaric settled in for a few hours of rest, his sword by his side, his thoughts on the trials ahead, and the princess he vowed to rescue. This night in the Garden of Shadows was but the first chapter in his quest, a testament to his resolve and a prelude to greater challenges. Each step took him further from the world he knew, deeper into a realm where magic ruled, and the boundaries of reality were as thin as the veil of mist that hung over the land. The path to Princess Elara and the confrontation with Morgath awaited, shrouded in mystery and danger. But Sir Alaric was ready to face whatever the forest and fate would throw his way. Chapter 2: The Deceptive Labyrinth. After surviving the ordeals of the Garden of Shadows, Sir Alaric continued his journey deeper into the realm of enchantment and danger. His next challenge was the Deceptive Labyrinth, a maze rumored to be designed by a mad sorcerer whose spirit still haunted its twisted paths. This labyrinth was no ordinary maze of hedges or stone walls. It was formed by living vines and towering trees, their branches woven together to create a network of passages that shifted and changed at the whim of the labyrinth's ancient magic. As Sir Alaric approached the entrance, the air grew thick with a magical fog that obscured his vision and dampened the sound of his footsteps. The entrance was marked by two massive oak trees, their trunks twisted together to form an archway. Carved into the arch was a warning in ancient script, barely legible and covered in moss. "Those who enter, beware the paths of falsehood." Determined, Sir Alaric stepped into the labyrinth, his hand on the hilt of his sword, and his senses alert to any trickery. The path path behind him vanished as soon as he moved forward, the branches knitting themselves together to seal the way back. Ahead, the corridors of the labyrinth stretched out in a dizzying array of choices. Each junction presented Sir Alaric with a riddle, spoken in whispers by the wind that rustled through the leaves. The riddles were crafted by the spirit of the sorcerer, designed to test the wit and wisdom of any who dared to navigate the labyrinth's depths. Each answer Sir Alaric gave would determine the path the labyrinth opened to him. A correct answer led him deeper towards the heart of the maze. A wrong one looped him back, or into a trap designed to discourage or detain. Feed me, and I live. Yet give me a drink, and I die. What am I? Whispered the first riddle at a three-way split in the path. Fire, Sir Alaric responded without hesitation, and the branches before him parted, allowing him passage to the next section of the maze. The challenges grew more complex as he ventured further. At one point, a clearing opened up, revealing a pond whose waters reflected not the sky above, but instead showed visions of possible futures. Sir Alaric saw himself standing victorious in the Witch Morgath's stronghold in one reflection, and in another, he was lost forever, wandering the labyrinth's never-ending twists. The voice of the sorcerer echoed around him. Choose the path that leads to your desire. Trusting his instincts, Sir Alaric turned away from the tempting visions and chose a narrow, overgrown path that seemed to lead further into darkness. His choice proved wise as the vegetation around him began to thin, hinting that he was nearing the center of the labyrinth. As night fell, Sir Alaric found himself in a vast circular clearing, surrounded by towering walls of ivy and thorn. In the center stood an ancient stone pedestal, upon which rested a single, glowing orb. The air hummed with latent magic, and the spirit of the sorcerer finally revealed itself, materializing as a wizened old figure clad in tattered robes, his eyes gleaming with a mix of madness and wisdom. Welcome, brave knight, the spirit spoke, its voice echoing off the stone walls. You have navigated my labyrinth with cleverness and fortitude. But before you can proceed, one final challenge awaits. You must defeat me in a duel of magic and wits. The duel was unlike any Sir Alaric had ever faced. The sorcerer summoned illusions of fearsome beasts and phantoms, each a manifestation of Sir Alaric's deepest fears and doubts. With each creature he vanquished, the knight had to shout a truth about himself, or answer a question about his deepest motivations. Why do you seek the Princess Elara? The sorcerer demanded, as a fiery apparition charged. To save her from harm, and because her safety ensures the peace of our realm, Sir Alaric shouted, striking the phantom down with his blade, which was now glowing with the light bestowed by his truthful declaration. With each correct answer, the orb on the pedestal glowed brighter, and the sorcerer's power waned. Finally, with a loud crack, the orb burst into light, engulfing the clearing and banishing the sorcerer's spirit with a satisfied cackle that faded into the night. As the light receded, Sir Alaric found that the walls of the labyrinth had dissolved, revealing the path forward. Exhausted but enlightened by the ordeal, he knew more about himself than when he had entered. His resolve hardened, and his mission clearer than ever. He now understood that this quest was not only about rescuing Princess Elara, but also about confronting and overcoming his own inner darkness. With the labyrinth behind him, Sir Alaric continued his journey, the first rays of dawn breaking over the horizon, signaling the start of a new day and the next chapter of his adventure. Chapter 3, The Great Clash. After the mental and mystical challenges of the deceptive labyrinth, Sir Alaric's next encounter brought him face to face with physical peril in its most formidable form. His journey led him to the Swamp Castle, a foreboding structure of stone and decay that emerged from the mists like a beast lurking in the shallow waters. This was the lair of Morgath, the witch who had spirited away Princess Elara, and it was guarded not by mere men, but by an army of statues, warriors of stone brought to life by dark enchantments. As Sir Alaric approached the drawbridge of the castle, the air was thick with the stench of the swamp and the heavy moisture that clung to every stone and leaf. The castle itself seemed to pulse with a malevolent energy, its turrets and spires casting long shadows across the murky waters. No birds sang here, and even the wind seemed to whisper warnings. Crossing the drawbridge, Sir Alaric entered the castle's outer courtyard, where the army of statues awaited. Arrayed in ranks, as if on parade, the statues were an eerie sight. Knights, archers, and spearmen, each carved from the dark granite of the swamp's bedrock, their eyes empty, yet alight with a magical fire. As Sir Alaric stepped forward, the ground beneath his feet rumbling with a dormant threat, the statues stirred to life. With a grinding sound of stone on stone, the statues moved into attack formation, their movements surprisingly fluid for beings made of rock. The air crackled with magical energy as they advanced, weapons drawn. Sir Alaric drew his own sword, its blade gleaming with a light enchantment, a necessary counter to the sorcery that animated his foes. The clash was titanic, the sound of metal against stone ringing out across the swamp. Sir Alaric fought with both sword and shield, parrying blows that could crush stone and delivering strikes with all his might. Each statue he shattered crumbled into rubble. Yet for everyone he destroyed, it seemed as though two more took its place. Realizing that brute force alone would not win the day, Sir Alaric retreated strategically towards the castle's great hall, drawing a portion of the statue army with him. There, amid the ancient columns and faded tapestries of the hall, he spotted the source of their animation, a large crystal pulsing with dark energy, mounted above the hall's central hearth. With the statues pressing him hard, Sir Alaric executed a series of swift maneuvers, his armor clanking and his breath coming in sharp gasps. Dodging an archer's bolt, he rolled forward and hurled his sword like a spear, aiming for the crystal. The blade struck true, shattering the crystal with a sound like thunder, and the magic that animated the statues flickered and died. One by one, the statues froze, their last positions held in eerie stasis as the enchantment that gave them life dissipated. With the immediate threat vanquished, Sir Alaric retrieved his sword and advanced deeper into the castle. The corridors were dimly lit by flickering torches, casting long, dancing shadows that seemed to move of their own accord. The air grew colder as he descended into the dungeons, the heart of Morgath's domain, and likely the place where Princess Elara was held. As he navigated the labyrinthine dungeon corridors, Sir Alaric's senses were alert to any sign of the princess or further traps. The silence was oppressive, broken only by the occasional drip of moisture from the stone ceiling. Finally, he came upon a heavy wooden door, bound in iron and locked with a spell. Standing before the door, Sir Alaric prepared himself for what might be his greatest challenge yet. He knew that beyond this barrier, he would likely face Morgath herself, and the outcome of that encounter would determine not just his fate, but that of Princess Elara, and potentially their entire realm. Drawing a deep breath, Sir Alaric raised his sword, the blade still glowing faintly with the remnants of the light enchantment. He muttered a counterspell, a piece of arcane knowledge he had gleaned from his previous encounters and studies. The lock clicked, the spell broken, and the door swung open with a mournful creak. Stepping into the chamber beyond, Sir Alaric braced himself for the final confrontation. His journey through the swamp castle had tested every facet of his courage and skill. Now, he faced perhaps the darkest aspect of his quest, the Witch Morgath, and whatever powers she might wield. As the door closed behind him, sealing off any retreat, Sir Alaric moved forward, ready to face whatever awaited in the shadowy depths. Chapter 4, The Revelation. The heavy door closed with a resounding thud behind Sir Alaric, the echo of its finality reverberating through the cold, damp air of the chamber. He found himself in a dimly lit room, the only light emanating from a few flickering candles that cast ghostly shadows against the stone walls. At the far end of the room, seated on a throne carved from dark wood and adorned with runes that glowed with a soft, eerie light, was the Witch Morgath. Her eyes, sharp and calculating, fixed on Sir Alaric as he stepped forward. "Welcome, Sir Knight." Morgath's voice was both melodic and chilling, filling the space with its resonance. "You have traversed the dangers I laid before you with admirable courage and skill. But do you know why you are truly here?" Sir Alaric gripped his sword tighter, though he knew that brute force might not avail him in this confrontation. "I am here for Princess Elara," he responded firmly, his gaze never leaving Morgath. "You have taken her against her will. I am here to return her to her people." Morgath laughed, a sound that seemed to contain both amusement and pity. "Oh, valiant knight, how little you understand. Elara is not a prisoner, not in the way you think." From the shadows to the side of the throne, a figure stepped forward. It was Princess Elara herself, unharmed and regal, her demeanor calm and composed. Sir Alaric's sword lowered slightly in confusion and relief at the sight of her. "Elara!" Sir Alaric exclaimed, his voice a mixture of joy and bewilderment. "You are well? Why do you stay here with this sorceress?" Elara's expression was serene as she addressed both the knight and Morgath. "Sir Alaric, I came here on my own accord. Morgath has not held me captive. She has been my protector." Sir Alaric's confusion deepened. Morgath gestured to a pair of chairs before her throne. "Sit, both of you. There is much to explain, and you deserve to hear the truth." As they seated themselves, Morgath began to unravel the tale. "Many moons ago, a conspiracy was born within your kingdom, one that sought to overthrow the royal family and usurp the throne. Elara's life was in grave danger." Elara continued, "When I discovered the plot, I knew I had to flee. Morgath, who many fear as a witch, is also a guardian of ancient secrets and protector of the royal line. She offered me sanctuary here, where no assassin's blade could reach me." Morgath nodded, her eyes dark with the weight of her duty. I have been watching over the princess, using my powers to veil this place from those who wished her harm. But the kingdom needs its princess, especially now as the conspirators grow bold and the realm teeters on the brink of chaos. Sir Alaric sat in stunned silence, absorbing the revelations. His mission, based on a premise of rescue, had been misguided from the start, manipulated by those who sought to use him as a pawn in their power games. But why not seek help? Why the secrecy? Sir Alaric finally asked, his brow furrowed in consternation. The fewer who knew of Elara's whereabouts, the safer her hiding was. Even you, brave knight, were not told the full truth to protect you and the princess from those who would interrogate you, Morgath explained. Elara reached out, placing a hand on Sir Alaric's. I am sorry for the deception and for the trials you have faced to find me. Your loyalty and bravery have not gone unnoticed or unappreciated. But now I ask for your help once more, not to rescue me from Morgath, but to stand by my side as I return. We must reveal the conspiracy and restore peace to our land. Moved by the truth and the trust placed in him, Sir Alaric nodded. I will serve you, my princess, in truth and with honor. Together, we will confront these traitors and reclaim your rightful place. Morgath stood, her figure imposing yet noble. I will aid you as well, with my knowledge and my magic. The path ahead will be perilous, but with truth and valor as your shields, you shall prevail. The chamber, once a place of presumed captivity, now felt like a sanctum of alliance and purpose. Sir Alaric, Princess Elara, and Morgath, the guardian witch, prepared to leave the swamp castle together. Their journey back would be fraught with danger, but each step would be taken with the certainty of their cause and the righteousness of their mission. As they stepped out of the chamber, back into the corridors of the swamp castle, a new chapter of their saga began. This time, Sir Alaric was not just a knight on a quest. He was a defender of the crown, a protector of the realm, and a champion of a princess who was far more than a damsel in distress. Together, they would face whatever challenges awaited, united by truth and strengthened by a newfound understanding of the complexities and deceits that lay beyond the simple tales of knights and dragons.